was in grad school, I had this internship where I was asked to write a paper on how to profile a network, or baseline a network, using just network flow data. And I said, okay, sure, sounds good. But what I was really thinking was, what is network flow data? And to make matters worse, I was gonna use this tool that was a Linux command line tool, and I had actually never used Linux before. Now, my boss at the time was a really good mentor, and he gave me an outline for the paper, and he showed me some basic commands to get me started. And I did manage to write the paper, and I actually got a job offer after the internship, so I guess I did okay. But that was my first introduction to network flow, and since then I've done a lot more complex analyses using just network flow data, and it's actually kind of cool what you can do with this type of data. So let me back up a minute for people who maybe aren't familiar with it. I'll give you a quick rundown on what it is. Many of you probably know what this is. It's a Wireshark packet capture, right? So you can think of network flow as essentially the metadata of packet capture. Packet capture, of course, is when you collect everything coming across a sensor. Network flow is a stripped down version of that. It's things like IP addresses, ports, protocols, TCP flags, byte counts, that sort of thing, but no actual user data. Typically doesn't have application layer data either unless you're using special collection sensors. I'm not gonna get into the types of collection sensors or the different tools you can use. I want this presentation to focus more on what the benefits and some of the drawbacks are for using network flow. So if network flow is just a stripped down version of packet capture, how could it be any better than packet capture? There are actually a lot of different reasons to use it. The biggest reason for some people is that it's small, which means the query time is very fast. You can store it for long periods of time for your network, and the bandwidth required to pull queries back and forth is a lot smaller than if you're using PCAP. It's automatable, like a lot of data sets are, depending on what tool sets you're using. And you generally don't have to worry about privacy concerns, especially if you're keeping the data in-house, because there's no user data involved. It's kind of like the difference between a call log versus a recording of a phone conversation. You know who called whom and when, but you don't know what they actually talked about. As with everything, there's some cons as well. The biggest one is probably that there's no true way to validate what's going on if you're just using network flow data. For example, I was troubleshooting a network in an exercise that we built once, and I saw what to me was very obviously a DDoS attack. There are a whole bunch of IP addresses attacking this one IP address that happened to be a domain controller on the network. But when I looked closer, I saw that it was a bunch of internal user machines that were booting up and going to the domain controller. They were just registering the machines, it wasn't a DDoS. But I couldn't validate that with just network flow data. It's a summary of a conversation, so if your analysis requires your data to be more granular, network flow is not gonna be your first choice for that. And it's yet another tool. It's yet another data set that you have to collect, provision, maintain, and analyze. So all of that said, what can you actually do with this data? I mentioned network profiling up front. That's an important thing to do, that's all well and good. But you can also use it for threat hunting. You can find known malicious IPs, you can look for anomalous traffic, beaconing, exfil, all kinds of stuff. Now, let me be clear, I'm not advocating that we just throw in another tool set, another data set, and hope for the best. I think that the most effective method of threat hunting, as many people here have already mentioned, is to have analysts who are well-trained and capable of critical thinking, and then give them the tools and the data that they need to do their mission. And I'll admit I'm a little biased, but I think that network flow should be one of those data sets that they have access to. Here's why. If you're an effective analyst, you can use network flow to find an attack at almost every stage of an intrusion. I have the kill chain up here just because I think everyone in the room is familiar with it, and I wanted to give us all a frame of reference for some of the examples I'm gonna talk about. Kill chain may or may not work for every analysis, but at least gives us a framework to be on the same page. active reconnaissance is pretty easy to find in network flow. You would see maybe an IP address, external IP, hitting your web server a bunch of times. Maybe they're looking for information about a corporation. You would definitely see port scans, ping sweeps, stuff like that. Weaponization, of course, happens on the attacker side, so you're not going to see that in network flow unless for some reason you have network flow from the attacker's network, which would be awesome, but most of the time we don't. You might see, if it happens to be an insider threat that you're looking at, you may see someone going to a known hacking website and pulling down a bunch of data. If it were someone in this room, no big deal, but if it's someone in your finance department, that's kind of weird. Maybe you should take a look at that. Delivery. Assuming it's a remote attack, you're going to see it in network flow. Delivery, of course, there are a bunch of different options for that. So you might see someone hitting a web server a whole bunch of times over and over and over and over again. Or you might see a bunch of large packets on an email protocol sent to everyone in your network. Maybe spam or maybe phishing, but something to look at. All kinds of options for delivery. Exploitation is generally thought of as a host-based step, so you're not going to see that in network flow. But what you can do with it is, if you have a box that has been successfully exploited, and especially if for some reason, you know, they've cleared the logs, you don't have forensics on it, you can use the network flow from just prior to that to get a picture of next steps and what you should look for. So, for example, if that was a web server that just got popped and you saw that traffic hitting your web server over and over, you might think could be a SQL injection, if that's a SQL backend, or you might think brute force password attack, something like that. If there's an installation phase, you'll probably see that in network flow. It'll probably show up as a whole bunch of large packets going to a machine. That data in and of itself is not really interesting, but if it comes from a known malicious IP, or if it comes from an IP address that just scanned your network, that makes it a little more interesting. It would also be interesting if it's a bunch of large packets on a protocol that shouldn't have large packets, like DNS or SNMP. Command and control, again, you'll see, we're assuming these are remote attacks. That's what makes them interesting, I think. You'd see beaconing definitely is very easy to detect in network flow, whether you're looking at a visualization, the traffic graph. You can also do it in streaming analytics with network flow data as well. If you're looking at an external connection coming inbound for C2, you might look at RDP connections that aren't supposed to be there, external connections that start from the outside that an internal host doesn't start, which is normal for web servers maybe, but not normal for user machines. Or you might see odd hours traffic. Stuff like that is what you'll look for with command and control. Actions on objectives, of course, can be a whole bunch of different things. Data exfil is really easy to see in network flow. Spike in traffic volume, real simple. Lateral movement is also easy to see if you're instrumented for network flow inside of your network, not just at your access points. You might, for example, notice that your web server is scanning your domain controller. That's bad. So some of these examples might seem maybe a little contrived or a little basic, or you might say, well, I can find that in PCAP, or I can find that in my SIM. You know, why do I need network flow anyway? When Sergio was up here this morning, I don't know if he's still here, he talked about the diamond model. I think that the diamond model is a really effective framework for doing intrusion analysis. I've seen a lot of high-end organizations using it, albeit informally and sometimes without even knowing that they're using it. But one of the main analysis approaches that relates to the diamond model, and I'm glad someone asked the question earlier and pointed it out, is the pivot. The network flow is perfect for using as a pivot. If you have, for example, a malicious IP address that you know is malicious from some intel or something, you can look that up in network flow and see if any of your internal IP addresses have touched that. And if you find those, then you can look those up in network flow and see if there's any anomalous traffic coming from that. If you have a timestamp from anomalous traffic, you can look that up in PCAP. She thought I was going to say network flow. You can look that up in PCAP or any other tool. And so on. So you start with your first query, you look it up in network flow, pivot off of that, change to a different tool, and you build out your picture of your adversary. So real world example of this, one of my colleagues was looking at a couple of IP addresses that were known malicious addresses from a particular APT. He was using network flow to look those up. He didn't find anything. So what he did was he took those IP addresses and expanded them to a /24 network block. Now, something like this is really easy to look up in network flow, to take a whole /24 network block, look it up for a year's worth of data on a massive network. That's no big deal. So that's exactly what he did. He looked those up, and here's what he found. He found several multi-gigabyte spikes in traffic outbound over several days from one internal IP address to three external IP addresses. He took that data, and since we had the internal IP address now, he and the customer at the time looked that up in their logs. And they were able to determine that this was a breach, that it was data exfiltration. Too late, unfortunately, to stop this one, but they were at least able to take those new IPs, those new indicators, and toss them back into the IDS. One of the things that I really like about network flow is that it's so quick. Like I said, you can do that full /24 block, 30 seconds, no problem. When we do exercises sometimes, we'll have analysts, hunters, whatever you want to call them, working on different tool sets to find a particular indicator or a particular event. There'll be someone on the IDS, someone on the SIM, someone on PCAP, and someone looking through network flow, usually for the first time ever. And generally what happens, and I might be a little biased, but generally what happens is that the person looking through the network flow is able to find the indicator and make a real quick interpretation before anyone else has really gotten a handle on what's going on with the other tools. Which brings me to another reason why I like network flow, and some of you may disagree with this. It forces analysts to use their critical thinking skills. If you don't have an IDS telling you what happened, and you don't have PCAP that you can look through to figure out the story, you have to make an interpretation based on your experience and your foundational knowledge of networks. And you might say, well, you know, that's not good. I want even my most inexperienced analyst to be able to do this. And I think it was Robert Lee who mentioned yesterday that we really want the threat hunters to be the more experienced analysts, and I tend to agree with that. The easy queries, the things like looking up an IP address, those can be automated, no big deal. I'm talking about the type of analysis where you have to be able to understand and explain what happened during an event. You have to be able to tell the who, what, where, why, when, and how. And you have to be able to make recommendations on how to mitigate it in the future. For example, I was running an exercise once where we had set up a simple beaconing, internal IP address beaconing out to a malicious IP. Fairly simple setup. And the group knew that the external IP was malicious, so it was really easy for them to find the activity. But we asked them to explain what was happening. Now, the particular analyst that was working on this was pretty junior, and he wasn't able to tell me anything beyond what the IDS was telling him, which honestly wasn't much other than there's a connection. So what I did was I walked him through the network flow data. We started with that external IP, we looked at who it connected to, who that connected to, et cetera. And through that process, we ended up going over how the NAT routing was set up in that network. We went through the DNS recursion set up in that network. We talked a little bit about standard versus non-standard ports. And we talked a little bit about standard or typical web traffic patterns. And after going over all of that with him, he was able to make a determination about what his next step needed to be to do the rest of his analysis. And in that case, it was he needed to pull PCAP from a particular internal IP address to finish it off. So hopefully I've given you at least a little bit of a picture about what some of the benefits are. And of course, there are
drawbacks as well. But I'm going to leave you with one more thing. I mentioned network profiling at the beginning, and or you can think of it as baseline or finding your cyber terrain, however you want to talk about it. And this is, of course, extremely important for network defense, figuring out what's on your network, who it's talking to, when it changes. And you can automate this. You can do it with all kinds of data sets. You can do it with network flow. Run it every day, week, month, whatever you want. So I was doing this process once on a particular network, and I was doing it manually for some reason. I have no idea why. But I was finding DNS servers manually. I was manually finding NAT routers. I was manually finding VPN concentrators. By the way, I think one of the important skills to have as an analyst or threat hunter is the ability to do scripting. So maybe I should have done that. When I got to the web servers, there were a bazillion of them. There were orders of magnitude more than what I had found for any of the other hosts on the network. And typically when you do profiling or baselining, especially if it's the first time you're doing it on your network, you'll find some weird stuff. You might find a web server that you thought was unplugged, but it's still sitting there active on the network. You might find some FTP traffic that you thought that you had locked down. Or you might find something weird like this. To know what was going on here, I'd have to tell you what I actually queried for. So for simplicity's sake, let's say that I was looking for outbound traffic from source 80 for my internal IP addresses, web port. So why would I have so many web servers on the network? I don't, right? For this analysis, all I had was network flow data, so I had to figure it out through that. After doing some different analytics, I realized that all of these hosts were responding to a low, slow stealth scan on web port 80, went across the entire network. And there are a whole bunch of problems with that from a network defense standpoint, right? The scan got in, nobody alerted on the scan. There are a whole bunch of user machines that are supposed to be locked down that are responding on port 80. That's not good. But the extra cool part was that we ended up with a couple of extra indicators that turned out to be IP addresses that are being used by a particular known APT that was specifically targeting this network. And in addition to that, we had the indicator of a new type of scan that that APT was using. So that's my plug for using network flow. I can talk, you know, a ton more about what analytics to use or what tools to use or that sort of thing. But I think one of the biggest pros to this is that it doesn't require any fancy tools. Just Linux skills if that's all you have.